Trump's proposed wall before Biden put a halt to its completion was to stop the entry of illegals crossing the US border from Mexico unchecked. And since then, more than 3 million people have settled in America. But the problem has also extended further north to Canada, where Mexicans are flying into the country, not requiring a visa and declaring refugee status. Joining us once again is our Canadian and North American and European correspondent, Michael A. Chabon, to discuss not only the immigration crisis, but gun legislation in Canada and the Georgia state runoff, and now the breaking news of a plot in Germany to overthrow the government. Morning, Michael.
Hey, Michael, so just breaking now over the wire, the German government, which is the German Federal Assembly, or called the Bundestag, was supposedly in threat of being overthrown by a far-right faction of a group that was going to, by force, take it over. 26 people have been arrested. Approximately 3,000 German police officers raided multiple jurisdictions to stop this far-right. These people were armed and organized. They were going to walk into the Bundestag and take it over by force. The German government basically said that it was comprised of, there was judges, there was military people, there were some old aristocratic people, but very much far right, and that they were going to march into the German Bundestag by force and take over the government. I mean, can you imagine in this day and age? I mean, it's incredible. So they're showing all the pictures now. There'll be more that will come out. But 3,000 police officers, you talk about an organized event. And like I said, multiple locations across Germany and 26 people of the highest organization who are putting this together to overthrow the German government. I mean, think of that for a sec. Germany holds so much money in the EU. They're basically propping up Italy and Spain and Portugal and Greece. That's all their money that's in there that they've been putting in. So can you imagine the turmoil that Europe would have gone through if something like that would have happened? Incredible, incredible news.
It's changing times, isn't it, Michael? We used to see foreign terrorism the biggest threat, and now it seems a lot of countries are actually grappling with domestic terrorism, the threat from within rather than external.
Well, to that point, I think what's happening in Iran and what's happening in China are good developments because they're challenging their government. They're telling them, we don't want your authoritarian rule. They've tasted freedom. They know what democracy is. They know what the internet is. They know what freedom of speech is. And they're not going to be held to these communist type autocratic rulers anymore. And they're now demonstrating. So those elements are good dissent. But you know, it's incredible to think what kind of a repercussion would that have had in Europe if they would have overthrown the German government? First of all, the embarrassment of doing that in any state, but just from a financial standpoint of the way Europe would have been put, it's incredible news, fascinating news.
Yeah, and more to unfold there. Well, let's jump back over to the US, Michael. Now, the immigration crisis in the US only getting worse.
Yeah, it's like 300,000 people a month are coming over illegally in the United States. And now it's a threat from Canada, too, if you want to take a perspective of that. In 2016, Canada lifted a requirement for Mexican nationals to have to apply for a visa to come to Canada. Many of them now are taking commercial airline flights to Canada and claiming asylum or tourism and then going into the United States through the Canadian northern border. Now, if you recall, many years ago, the UK had a problem with Romanians. They were called the Roma. They were shunned in Europe because nobody wanted them. They would transport their problems wherever they would go. They would go in caravans. And they were suspected of being gypsies and groups of fortune tellers and crime syndicates. So the UK had to place what some would call a discriminatory law, but say, no more. We don't want you to transport your elements in here. Now, if you look at what's going to happen in the United States, Title 42 is something during the Trump era that was passed to stop people from asylum seeking in Mexico because of the COVID pandemic. So border officials would be able to maintain them over there. They're saying now that if you think it's 300,000 people a month that are coming, it could double because of all these people now because of Title 42 is come off. And now the added problem of some leaching in through Canada and also Canada now, there's through some of the Indian reserves, we're getting some of the Mexicans and Puerto Rico and South American people who are coming into Canada from the United States because they're afraid of being deported. I mean, it's just a crazy set of circumstances. circumstances.
Yeah, Michael, we had the same problem here in Australia. Most of the focus goes on the boat people, the illegal immigrants arriving by boat. But by far the biggest proportion of people who fly in legally to start with and overstay their visas, that's the largest illegal immigration problem we have here.
In Australia, you send those boats back, though, don't you?
Yeah, we have a turnaround policy. So no one that arrives by boat will be settled here regardless.
Right, because as soon as you accept, I mean, Giovanni, the Italian prime minister, she did that same thing. She sent the boats back because as soon as you start accepting them, that's a gateway to come back more.
I mean, yeah, and then people die on that journey.
Yeah, I mean, it's terrible.
Justin Trudeau trying to put in place some fairly restrictive gun laws. Canada has a lot of guns, but not the gun violence that we see in America. And Trudeau is trying to pass more restrictive gun laws, Michael.
Well, I think the United States has 350 million people. I think they have 400 million guns. Canada has 35 million people. We don't have anywhere near 30 million guns. We have a huge restrictive gun policy in Canada. For instance, any gun that has a barrel length 4 inches or less is considered a prohibited and an illegal gun because the Canadian government deemed it as being a Saturday night special. But what Prime Minister Trudeau is trying to do, he's trying to introduce Bill C-21, which basically puts a freeze on all purchase, exchange, or buying and selling or transfer of any handguns. You can't even bring in a handgun from anywhere else into the country. And he's trying to institute a comprehensive buyback where they've banned about 1,500 different types of what they call assault rifles. Now, Canada never had assault rifles like that they've got in the United States. These are shotguns and these are hunting guns that have all kinds of add-on aftermarket stuff on it. But they've increased now, the government here has increased, they're going to have a restrictive firearm license in case of domestic abuse, penalties for smuggling. And then we have this, what they'll call a red flag law, which means if I don't like you, Michael, and I know you own a handgun, I'm going to call the cops and tell them you're a crazy man. So they're going to say, oh my God, he's a crazy man. We're going to have to take his gun license away. That's where we're coming to here. And there are many provinces in Canada feel that it's basically an affront to their civil liberties. And the government's saying, oh yeah, we're going to pay you about $1,000 or $2,000 a gun. There's 150,000 registered legal firearms in Canada, which they're talking about confiscating. And right now, Marco Mendocino, who's the Minister for Public Safety, says that he doesn't rule out a full ban of Canadian handguns. I mean, it's absolutely terrible. And basically, it comes down to the same argument. It's the same argument the United States has. Law-abiding gun owners are not the people who are creating the crimes. The guns are being brought in illegally from the United States, and it is criminal activities, gangs, and black-on-black shooting and killing that is going on. It's not legitimate handgun owners. And I mean, it's just absolutely ridiculous. If you want to buy an illegal gun, it's between $4,000 and $6,000. And just as a final note on this, the last time the Canadian government felt that it was a brilliant idea to register all the handguns, they spent $1 billion, Michael, and registered 15 million guns. I mean, it's insane. Like, why don't they just raise the penalties of people who have illegal guns? Why don't you raise the penalties for the importation of possession? Because you see, what really happens here, and this is the honest to goodness truth, is a handgun charge is used as currency. And you say currency, well, it's currency in charging. So if you created a criminal act, a drug act of some sort, and you were caught with an illegal weapon, I will remove the illegal weapon charge if you turn over on the guy who did your thing. I'm using the gun charge as a form of currency in sentencing and in charging. So it's all screwed up, and it's just terrible because sports shooters, hunters, and legitimately anybody west of Ontario who has a handgun or has a rifle is doing that because they have a farm, a wheat farm, a lentil farm, they have horses, they have rodents, they have bears, they have et cetera, et cetera. We're not talking about the guy in downtown Toronto. But if you're a guy in downtown Toronto who has a handgun, the hoops and ladders that you have to go through with trigger locks, independent briefcases, which are locked inside a gun safe, locked. You have to be a member of a certified gun club, and you have to be a member in good standing. And it's just all these hoops and things that you have to go through while a buddy who wants to go out and buy an illegal gun and sell drugs and shoots another guy is the one who's affecting legitimate handgun owners. Here we go again.
Yep. Now, the all-important Georgia
Rifle. That's too emotional. I'm sorry.
That's okay, Mike. Don't get your gun out. The all-important Georgia runoff has been decided.
Yeah, I mean, oh my God. So they had 3.5 million votes, basically what it was going to decide who was going to be able to run the Senate. And Herschel Walker, who was the propped up Republican candidate, basically only got 48% of the vote, and Raphael Warnock got 51% for the Democrats. So now the Democrats control the Senate with a 51-49 majority. So basically, the House in the United States is controlled by the Republicans, and the Senate is controlled by the Democrats. So what's going to happen now? Everything's going to get all stirred up because the Senate is the House of Final Review and Approval. But what it does do is it empowers Joe Manchin and Kristen Sinema, who are the two Democrats that didn't necessarily agree with everything Biden was proposing in his agenda. So there may be still a savior in here, but now it's the big blame game. I mean, for all intents and purposes, Herschel Walker was not the best candidate. And furthermore, the Republicans have to understand the way that they presented themselves and the way that they pitched this election was wrong. The Democrats spent $300 million in a by-election. That just goes to show you how important that was. And the Republicans spent $100 million. So there's a lot of dead bodies laying around because now they're saying, we got to look at this in a different way. It's all about advanced voting, mail-in voting, and the way that they address what their value proposition is. So there's going to be a bit of a turmoil now, and I think it's good. The one thing I will say is that Trump now represents the history of the Republican Party and not the future of the Republican Party. I think when they have their nominee candidate selection, I don't think Donald Trump is going to be in there. And I still believe Christine Noem from Montana and Rick DeSantis from Florida are the two best tickets to run this horse. But God forbid who they're going to prop up to put for the Democrats. I don't know. And it's going to be very volatile because the Republicans now are going to start investigating the Hunter Biden laptop that everybody didn't do. And you've got Twitter now showing all these things with the FBI being involved in suppressing news. There's lots of things that are going to come out that are going to be quite detrimental to what people thought was a democracy that was really thumbs on the scale from the Democrats. So we'll have to see if that's going to make a big difference in the 2024 election.
And the Senate's vitally important as well in America because the Democrats now get to appoint judges, don't they, with the power in the Senate?
Not only judges, they have a mandatory or a majority in any of these committees. So they can start delaying things. And when you talk about appointing judges, that's something that's very important because the Supreme Court in the United States makes huge decisions which determine the path at which America goes forward. Donald Trump, I believe he appointed two Supreme Court judges, if I'm not correct. And that made a huge difference in maintaining America's very conservative point of view. Now with the Democrats having that ability to do that, if Biden is smart or if he remembers it, that would be something that he should pursue for sure. But I don't think Biden's going to get any better. Again, all these flubs that are going on and missing things and stating things, it's actually a sad state of affairs. When you really see how this man has been propped up as the president of the United States, supposedly the strongest power in the world.
Yeah, I think the Conservative Party is saying that was Trump's greatest achievement was the number of judges he got onto the circuits and into the Supreme Court because it has such a big impact rather than any legislative effect that his efforts produced.
Well, many things that Trump presented were excellent for the United States. The messenger was the problem. Yeah. There was just some as there was some decisions that went down where a major person who was in the Trump organization was getting free cars and a tuition for his kid and bonuses and stuff, which was under the table. Not that that doesn't happen in every other company in the United States to evade taxes, but because they were micro focusing on Donald Trump, he was pronounced guilty. So the unfortunate reality is, although Trump had many good ideas, he's the wrong messenger. And I think the shine on that shilling, as my late mother-in-law used to say, has been tarnished a bit. The Republican Party has to move on. The Republican Party has to readdress what people look at and what people think as Republicans. And it's got to be border. It's got to be taxes. It's got to be China. It's got to be police. It's got to be these left-wing attorneys general. I mean, there's more crime that's going on. People in Texas are going to start taking it in their own hands. You watch. You're going to have civilians shooting people who are starting to rob people. And that's going to be a whole other cacophony of problems.
Will Trump go quietly into the night, and will his fervent and loyal supporters coalesce behind a new candidate, or will they be that disenfranchised with the Republican Party for not supporting their man that they could effect a bit of a reprimand on them?
Trump supporters are very Trumpish. They're behind him. They believe him. He was singled out. The problem is there's just too much baggage. You have to look at the greater good of the party. If you can't propose a candidate that nationally is going to be accepted, you have a problem. If every time you have to sit there and explain, oh, he didn't do that, or yeah, he did that, but yeah, this, you can't do that. I think that the Republican Party's nomination is going to be a very quiet, how should one say, reckoning for all the ill-begotten accusations and the unpresidential things that he did. But again, there's many things that he instituted in his administration, which was very good for America. But he's the wrong guy for the ticket. Ron DeSantis, I believe, still the governor of Florida, ran his state even in a COVID situation, made independent decisions. Florida is in a better state economically. Florida is in a better way from tourism. Their people are happy. When you look at Christine Noem from Montana, she's a mother. She's a well-spoken, very intelligent politician, ran her state with an iron hand and did a great job. Her people love her as well. That is the two people that I think the Republicans need to put forward, because there is so much appeal on so many avenues. Trump, unfortunately, has got too much baggage. And, you know, like I said, he represents the history, not the future of the Republican Party. That's a hard thing to say for many people. But I think if they truly reflect on what he could do in jeopardizing a Republican president in 2024, you've got to bite the bullet, and sometimes you got to swallow bad medicine to feel better.
Yeah, we've already seen him come out swinging against Mitch McConnell, Kevin McCarthy. I think he had a bit of a go at him as well.
Like, what do you do that for? Like, what purpose does that serve? Little cranky little kid going, no, 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 no. What are you doing that for? How does that purport a Republican Party that's unified, that's going to lead the country? And also, he did some slams against a DeSantis, calling him names and stuff. You can't do that. That is a petty element of politics that's passe, and that's going to be his demise, because he's going to start to do that kind of stuff, and they're just going to rip him a new one, because it's like, we're past all that. We saw the bodacious kind of tra-la-la with all the, you know, the bells and whistles. Now we've got to get down to brass tacks. America is facing a crisis. America is facing a recession. There are over 3 million illegal aliens. There are 1 million gotaways. There's, I think it's 3 million or 4 million dreamers who still have to have what they've got settled. You know, you've got China who's encroaching on the world. You've got North Korea, South Korea. You've got Iran. You need a leader who's got his business together. You can't be sitting there throwing accusations and petty bullshit, if you pardon the expression, with Twitter and all the rest of that. You got to be a president. But in the same thing, you can't have the guy turning around saying, I don't know where to go. You know, I'm eating ice cream. Biden went for 26 ice creams, but he's never been to the southern border. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's insane. It's just nuts. It's nuts. Well,
2 years to go, Michael, 18 months out, we'll start to see where we go. When do the nominations have to be in for the presidential?
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know that, but I will tell you that is going to be one heck of a place to be to see all the backroom deals that are going to go on, because I'm going to tell you there's going to be lots of people are not going to support another circus round and jeopardize losing it. And the Republicans better get their business together, because this whole thing with Herschel Walker showed a weakness that they didn't address mail-in ballots, and they didn't address getting the vote out and getting the message out early enough, because so many millions of people voted before other commercials hit. It was kind of like in Philadelphia. They had the debate 2 weeks before the debate, when already more than a quarter of the people have already voted. No, they got to get their business together. And I think there's going to be a bit of a shakeup, because this Herschel Walker business is a little bit of an embarrassment. They should have won this seat, and they should have had control of the Senate. But it is what it is.
Thankfully, we've got you to cover it all for us, Michael. So we'll look forward to chiming back in next week. Have a great week.
My pleasure. Thank you, Michael. And thank you to your informer viewers.